Hi, this is Angel Regis with Music Gods Magazine, and we have a wonderful guest today, Mr. Christopher Neal. Christopher is a music producer, songwriter, artist, sound engineer, and entrepreneur. He's the owner of Big Is Life Recording Studio in Elizabeth, New Jersey. And we would like to say a hearty welcome, Christopher. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm doing fine. Thanks for having me on. It's a pleasure.
Awesome. So, Chris, we'd like to our listeners to get a little feel for who Christopher Neal is. Could you give us a little tidbit into who you are, where you're from, and how did you get into the music business?
Well, I'm a musician from the little island in the Caribbean called St. Lucia.
Mm-hmm.
And pretty much that's where I started, and I believe that I've always had this music in me. I think from as far as I know myself could talk, you know, I've always been attracted to the radio. Mm-hmm. As a kid, I'm talking like 3-4 years old, the radio always used to fascinate me whenever I heard music, you know.
And, right.
So pretty much, I think that's where it started for me.
Mm-hmm. So you say you're from the island of St. Lucia, that's in the West Indies. Now, this is interesting because there are many artists that we hear, you know, that are on the mainstream. We usually hear from Jamaica or Trinidad and Tobago. How does a little boy from St. Lucia migrate to the U.S., make it as an entrepreneur and an artist, a songwriter? How did you get from the little island in St. Lucia to here in the U.S.? Give us a little, so to speak, a little playback into your world, and how did you get from there to here?
Well, my journey really began, I think, it's a journey I think probably a lot of musicians go through. Mm-hmm. Pretty much I started off, like I said, I was like music. I was always fascinated with music on the radio, although I didn't really even understand. I remember when I first heard that you have to play C and B, and I never knew such was in music, you know. It was like Greek to me. But really, and typically, I started off at school, high school, and there were other kids at the school, my classmates, who had kind of the same interests as me, and we put a band together, and I think that's where it all began. Mm-hmm. Fortunately for me, I was kind of lucky. I was still at high school that I remember once this guy called me up and said, hey, there's a band who needs a lead singer at one of the hotels, you know, are you interested? I remember I was in my last year of high school.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, sure. He told me, just come. You don't have to take the job. Just come and listen. And, and I came and heard the band. I remember that was my first day of my last year at high school.
Oh.
And the band leader asked me to, they were playing a song that I was familiar with. He told me, would I like to sing a song? And I went up, and that was history from then.
Wow. And, so was that... Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's fine. And so pretty much I ended up where I thought that I would have taken, you know, start music after high school. I began singing at the different hotels around the island at on my last year when I was supposed to be taking my schooling serious. It was a kind of hard thing to juggle, you know, but somehow music was my first passion, you know, but I still ended up managing it.
Okay. What musical genre do you gravitate more towards? Because I know in the islands, especially St. Lucia, we have calypso, reggae, you know, even country and western. Yes, we do have that over there. Was it R&B? what genre were you more fascinated with and just ran with that?
As a kid, I think I was really fascinated with Motown. Something about the Motown sound just had me.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know whatever it did to me, you know. As much as I'm from the islands, when I grew up as a kid, reggae was it grew on me as I grew older.
Right, right.
But I think I have more influence with the Motown sound.
Here's an interesting question for you, because we see that a lot of artists, and I'm going to talk about more from the Caribbean, calypso, reggae. Why is it that we don't see a lot more young artists, more on, you know, on the mainstream, getting probably, you know, more deals, or now that we have social media, which pretty much leverages the information, you know, worldwide, why are we not seeing more artists from that part of the world, you know, featuring their music and their talents? Why do you think that is?
I think it's all about getting investors to believe and market the artists, because believe me, there are ridiculous amount of talent from all of the islands. It's just in abundance, you know. I sometimes tell people back home that they don't know how lucky they are, you know, despite I'm in America. It is still easier when I was back home to have a network of musicians that you could just call, like, with a snap of a finger and get excellent musicians. Rather here, it's harder. Yeah.
Right.
So I think it's all about the marketing. And it's a funny thing. Back in the Caribbean, the artists tried to do everything on their own, which shouldn't be, you know, and I think that's one of the biggest problems. I don't know if it's in our mindset too, especially from the Caribbean. Sometimes, I'm just talking from experience, a lot of artists sometimes reluctant to take that chance to allow somebody else to take their music to another level. They always feel somebody's trying to rip them off, or, you know, I mean, but it's a chance you have to take, you know, because talent is really not all, you know. It's just probably 1% of the whole pie.
Right. So do you think that, I mean, this is 2017 where, you know, phenomenal, we have entrepreneurs popping up from all over the place. Do you think that with so much more resources that are readily available here in North America, that we might start seeing a bit more artists coming out, you know, or actually either from mentorship programs to probably forums in music, and even, you know, big name studios showing more of an interest to be able to pull those emerging artists from the Caribbean so that they have more, you know, they have more opportunities to feature their music and their talents?
I mean, this is all part of my whole journey. I believe in education, and I think it's key, you know, educating the artists about the business. It's not just about coming on stage and sing. You know, it's a whole, it's a bigger package, you know, and sometimes a lot of we producers are to be blamed too, because I think it's a job of the producer to take the dream of the artist and take it to that another level that they would like to be, but they can't really understand where it's supposed to go. So sometimes a lot has to do with the producers, and I think it's time, it's everybody has to take ownership of the whole scene.
Absolutely. And what I'm hearing is that understanding the business of the business from all disciplines, whether you are an engineer to the artist or, you know, a songwriter, I think we all do need education in that, you know, from that aspect. What are some of the areas that you've learned and become better at, you know, a better entrepreneur and artist that you didn't know, you know, growing up as a young man trying to feel your way through? You know that music was your passion, this is what you want to do, but of course you didn't have all the tools that you needed to make you who you are today. What are some of the some of the lessons and that you've learned along the way? Because we know we have a lot of young artists coming up today, and they think it's a, you know, you just gain that notoriety overnight. You know, you become this big name artist overnight. You know, you just, I got a few beats, and this is going to be it. This is it for me. Mm-hmm. What advice can you give them?
The funny thing is, I started off as an artist.
Mm-hmm.
However, I always considered myself a producer, even as a kid, because even when I became an artist, I used to look at music from a producer standpoint, even if I couldn't play. You know, I always used to imagine as a kid, believe it or not, I wish there was some kind of technology where I could put down my ideas, you know, and strange, I mean, with technology now, everything is right in a box in front of your face now.
Right,
it just became reality so fast. But I'm saying that to say that, answering your question, as an artist, one thing I've learned, especially growing up, is try to avoid trying to do what you hear on the radio. You have to be true to yourself, just to you. And I think that's one of the biggest mistakes we make, especially from the Caribbean. Everybody's doing the same thing. When Carnival comes, it's the same music, and after a few months, it just gets lost. You know, there's hardly anything that stands out, and it's very important that we, and I think we have what it takes to stand out. I think we're just trying to follow fashion, and I think that's the biggest mistake we're making as artists in particular.
Okay, so this brings us to where we are presently with your biggest live recording studio in Elizabeth, New Jersey. I know you work with, quite a few artists from a wide array of disciplines and genres. Could you give us a little view into the type of music genres that you like to, you know, work more with as opposed to another? Or is there a particular genre that you like to, you know, work more with than, you know, any other, whether it's calypso or, you know, reggae or R&B,
I believe my strength is calypso and reggae, because, I mean, it's in me. I mean, it's just natural. I don't have to think, you know. You just put down a beat and it comes out. If you want to do a soca beat or a reggae beat, whatever, it's just in you. But, no, I'm getting brain freeze now.
You're good. this is some good nuggets you're giving our audience right here. You're fine.
But, I mean, there's no particular genre of music I would really say that. I mean, because what I do at Biggest Life, especially coming here from the Caribbean, it exposed me to more genres of music. Imagine today I have a mariachi guy coming to the studio. And
that's interesting.
You know, mariachi is not my thing. But, right. I mean, you know, the funniest thing, you know, he's been working with me for about the last 3 years. And he's from El Salvador. And he does mariachi music. But strange, when we first started, he used to say, "Hey, Chris, you know, it's not really mariachi, you know. I mean, it can't be mariachi, really, because there's a Chris spin on it, you know."
Mm-hmm.
But over the past few years now, he is so excited with that sound that we've captured.
Mm-hmm.
Because despite I'm doing the mariachi, I still have my Caribbean spin on it. That
right.
His music sounds so fresh.
Oh,
that he is just so excited about it, you know, and now he's on his second album. And he's getting a lot of play in El Salvador, and he's performing at all the little bars around the place in Elizabeth.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Well, that's exciting. That leads me into this question. Is that an area where we might see a lot more of Christopher Neal productions in that type of genre of music? I know you just pretty much just getting your feet wet or just getting into shaping your own sound with that type of genre. Are we going to see more of that type of music coming out of Big as Life Recording Studio, you think, in the near future?
I never restrict myself to anything. I never even plan anything in how I'm gonna create a sound. You know, It just I just allow things to happen and take it from where it. Because when he brought the mariachi sound to me, it was like Greek to me. You know, imagine doing music with no drums. He has no drums in the music. It's all about guitars, pretty much. And imagine I have to be playing guitars digitally, you know, and make it sound believable.
Right.
So it was a real challenge to me. But coming from St. Lucia in particular, where we have such a St. Lucia being English and French back and forth 14 times, we've had this English and French influence. So the European vibe or the kind of folk, European folk music, is part of our culture too. And I think it's pretty much close to the Spanish music too. So that kind of helped me in figuring out where to take his kind of music.
Right. So I know that you started as an artist and now you've merged into this bigger world of, you know, producing and writing and sound engineer and an entrepreneur. Where do you see yourself as an artist in the near future? Do you think that we'll get some more of Christopher Neal, the artist, work coming out, or you pretty much entrepreneur doing, you're wearing your many hats and doing working with other artists?
Like I said, I try not to restrict myself. I mean, I've been making music for years, you know, pretty much. I've been making music for other people, unfortunately, which is, I see a bit of Christopher Neal in everything I do for anybody else, you know. However, I think I'm at the point where it's time to do me, and I'm actually, I've been thinking of it for the last few years, and this is one of the projects on my menu for this year. Mm-hmm. However, it's a funny thing, you know, when you being an artist and then jumping from an artist and now being a producer to produce yourself, it's a funny thing, you know. I don't know how to produce myself because I think I'm my biggest critic. Will I like that? Am I happy with this?
Aren't we all, though, right?
So what the plan I arrived at is to collaborate with some of my biggest influence mentors in the music business. Mm-hmm. And I've already contacted a few of them, and I hope to. So the whole album for me will be a collaboration. It's still going to be Christopher Neal, but with all my close buddies or guys that I grew up with or I looked up to in the music industry. I want to allow them sort of to produce me as an artist with my little spin on it.
So this might put you on the spot a little bit, but, you know, I'm just trying to get some nuggets for our, you know, artists or professionals or, you know, who are, you know, the young who's trying to make it in, or they just can't break that cycle of not making it, so to speak. You talked about collaborating. What is some, some little advice that you can give artists that, you know, and I always go back because this is where your roots are from, St. Lucia, the Caribbean, because a lot are, you know, they're going to be listening, wanting to know how do they get from there where they are, being their local superstars, whether it's Kaiso or reggae or, you know, how did they bridge that gap? How did they get from there to here in the U.S. or Canada, U.K. to give some more awareness to their work? How can they collaborate with musicians or artists that are already doing it big, you know, so that they can be tethered to them and be just as, just as big as they are? How can they do that? Because they don't know. The resources are not there.
I'm really happy you asked that question because I was about to tell you it's a hard question to answer if I'm talking directly to the artist.
Right.
Because I've reached a point where I've seen, in fact, I know myself. The good thing about it is, like I said, I started as an artist, I mean, back in the days. And I kind of understand, you know, that it is, you could only do so much as an artist. Really, as a matter of fact, you only supposed to do so much, you
right.
know, which is focus on your craft and let somebody else handle taking you to that other level. And I think that's where it lies upon the producers and the promoters, and you know, we have to come together to take our music to that another level, because like I said, the talent is there. There's no question about it.
Yeah.
I go to St. Lucia and I just freak out, you know. You go to the local bars and see guys playing jazz and R&B, just regular hip-hop, and they sound better than the guys playing in a club in Manhattan, you know.
What?
So it's not about the talent. It's about getting, you know, and the artists could only do so much, I think. I think they have already done what they have to do. We now have to take it to that next level and try to get the music across.
Right. What, with that being said, what are some of the, are there any organizations or any, you know, platforms that you can think of that, you know, or perhaps, you know, we have, you know, musicians that are who are here in North America who, you know, have those connections or, you know, the background where they can, you know, come together, collaborate, build alliances, and help those that are trying to get, you know, those artists that are trying, are there any organizations or, you know, that they can reach out to from the artist perspective, you know?
It's all about connections and who you know. And I've been fortunate since I've been here to know a few people who've been in the business, you know. I've been working with this guy called Stephen Flagg. He used to once manage the Wu-Tang. So, I mean, he got one of a track I did for one artist on MTV. You know, so it's all about connections. And I think it's almost a must now for we Caribbean people or other people, investors who want to take their chance and go down there and start sort of harvesting, bringing the talent over here. Because I'm telling you, make no mistake, there is talent.
Right.
Yeah, and so I think connections is all about it. And it starts with me, too. I'm to be blamed,
right.
too. I haven't really gone home and tried to. The funny thing is, this is not me trying to go and hustle to promote people. And I try to focus more on getting the music sounding right, you know, and have other people handle that aspect of it.
No.
It's a whole teamwork, I think.
Absolutely. I believe that. Collectively, so much can be done. You know, collective mindsets, resources, opportunities, you know, each one teach one. I you know, totally believe in that. So let's talk about Big Is Life Recording Studio and the services that you offer. And, you know, just give us a little view into the life of the entrepreneur.
Big Is Love actually was formed by me and three other guys about 8 years ago. Two other St. Lucians, Sherwin Bryce, very talented musician, very, very talented guy, and Russell Thomas, also Jersey Rays. The funny thing about Big Is Life is, despite it was set up by the four of us, I was the only one that was on the ground. We had Sherwin in St. Lucia. We had Russell in Texas. And Jersey was in Hawaii. So I mean, we did what we have to do as a team, you know.
Right.
It reached a point now where actually I've taken over everything now because everybody's just... But we're still excellent friends. And, I mean, bigger than I've been doing... When we started... 8 years ago, it was really rough. setting up a studio in a town that nobody knows you, it's just, it's really hard. Unlike in St. Lucia, you could set up a studio in a tree and everybody going to know where you are, you know. It's that small.
Right.
It's, you know, if it's just word of mouth and everybody will find you. Here, you have to do the marketing and it takes a lot. But over the years, we've built a good clientele to at least sustain us paying the bills. We've worked with a few artists under the Biggest Live, not as a label really, but we tried it. I mean, it was a part of the whole journey and experience, which I really enjoyed. Mm-hmm. But right now, also what's happening at Biggest Live is I'm connected with a company called Recording Connection. I don't know if you've heard of them. It's an online school based out of L.A.,
mm-hmm.
and they are, it's a audio recording engineering course. Well, not just, it's just a whole audio course. So if any student want to take it on, they do the course online. And say, for instance, if we have a student who is in my area, they will assign the student to do their practicals with me.
Oh, okay.
And it's been working out quite nice over the last, it's about a year and a half now since I've been connected with them, and we have a few students that come. So right now I'm into the teaching thing now.
Oh, that's great.
It's a lot of fun.
That's great.
And they are endorsed by all the top engineers from Dave Pensada, Quincy Jones, everybody.
Oh, even better. I like Biggest Live Recording Studio. So what I'm hearing as, you know, as an entrepreneur, and you just clearly stated that, you know, you can start as an artist, and that's where your passion lies, and, you know, you just tunnel vision. But be open. Be open to growing as an individual, as an artist, and there you are as an entrepreneur doing wonderful things, and now your business is growing. You've been in business for over 8 years. And what I'm also hearing is that, you know, persevering, and that goes with everyone, regardless if you are an artist or an engineer, whatever you're doing in life, sticking with it, staying mm-hmm. focused, being open to change. And, you know, we hear that in your statements over and over again, being open to doing something new, to learning something new. And there you are on the other end of it, teaching through your collaborations with the school. I just think it's wonderful what you're doing. Could you please let us know how we can get hold of you? Because this is, you know, it's just wonderful to speak to entrepreneurs and artists such as yourself and who are doing wonderful things in our communities. We need to know, where can we get hold of you? How can we reach out to you, support you? Please let us know.
Well, we have a website online, biggestliferecords.com. And, of course, you can get me at Biggest Live Recording Studio. So I guess once you do a Google search, we're going to pop up.
All right.
In Elizabeth, New Jersey, pretty much, I think. Yeah, it's probably the only one around, so, with that name.
Mm-hmm.
And,
what I'd also like to add, and I was, like, closing with, what nuggets of wisdom can you leave with us so that we, you know, our listeners can, you know, take it and run with it?
Believe in yourself. I think it's key. Never give up. Always, you know, follow your dream, because, I mean, technology, yeah, we have a lot of platforms now with the social media and everything. We have to make use of what we have. I know it's a bit harder because the competition is more than in back in the days. But all things are possible. It's all about being true to yourself. Try not to follow fashion. I think that's the biggest mistake we can ever make as an artist or just as in any business. You have to stand out. And I think I learned it the hard way. Make no mistake, I was an artist too. I wanted to sound like Michael Jackson. I wanted to do, you know. So it's almost a natural thing. So like I keep saying, it's the job of the producers now to say, hey, we're not going on that road. please.
Right.
And I think a good team, and I think everything will be just fine. But you got to believe in yourself.
There you have it, folks. Sound advice from Mr. Christopher Neal, music producer, songwriter, artist, sound engineer, and entrepreneur who is the co-owner of Big Is Life Recording Studio in Elizabeth, New Jersey. This is Angel Regis. Thank you for listening. This is Music Gods Magazine, leveraging superstardom to the masses. Thank you.
Hi, this is Christopher Neal. I just want to big up Music Gods Magazine. I want to thank you for this wonderful interview, and just keep doing what you're doing. It's such an awesome platform that you've given us, and we're very thankful to it. Big up, Music Gods.